I'm Kimberly Arusha, Managing Director of the USGA Green Section. I'd like to welcome you to How It's Done. These presentations summarize methods and procedures observed by Green Section agronomists as they visit golf courses throughout North America. We are not suggesting that the procedures depicted are the best or only means of performing a particular task. Our goal is to share a broad variety of methods so that golf courses may benefit from the ideas and techniques.
Greetings, everyone, and thank you for tuning in to this How It's Done presentation. My name is Brian Whitlark, USGA agronomist in the Southwest region. And in this How It's Done presentation, we will discuss a strategy to fix low-lying areas in fairways, especially instances in which salt accumulation is problematic. Typically, in these problem areas, the hydraulic conductivity of the soil is extremely slow, often less than 2/100ths of an inch an hour. As a result, root growth is limited, and if the golf facility irrigates with saline water, salts may accumulate to reach harmful levels in the soil. In this How It's Done presentation, we will use examples from two golf facilities in southern Arizona. The first is the Seville Golf and Country Club in Gilbert, Arizona, where Mr. Gus Rota is the golf course superintendent. An area about 15,000 square feet in the landing zone of number 5 fairway contained very high salts and turf quality was poor. An electrical conductivity meter, or EC meter, was used to measure the salt content in this low-lying area, revealing elevated salinity at 6.76 millisiemens, which is equivalent to about 19 decisiemens per meter if you were to collect a sample on a saturated paste EC test. And an image of that salt reading is shown on the left on this slide. The second golf facility is Sun Lakes Country Club at the Cottonwood Golf Course in Sun Lakes, Arizona, where Mr. Bill Todd is the golf course superintendent. A portion of the 12th fairway has been plagued with poor turf quality for many years, and this low-lying area contained high salt content at 5.72 millisiemens, or about 16 decisiemens per meter on the saturated paste test. And then image of that salt reading is shown on the right photo on this slide. Mr. Rota completed the process described in this presentation in the summer of 2012, and Mr. Todd recently completed the process in the summer of 2013, and the results at both sites have been overwhelmingly positive. Now let's continue by describing the process step by step. Step one is planning, and this might be just the most important step in the entire process. Golfers and staff members should be informed well ahead of the process so all parties know how long to expect the area to be closed. The project areas at Seville and at Sun Lakes, which coincidentally both were done on par 5 holes, were partially closed during the construction project, and golfers were able to play the holes as par 3s. Depending on the size of the area and the method to re-establish grass on the site, whether using sod or sprigs, plan to close the project area for 6 to 12 weeks. The equipment necessary to complete the project will vary from course to course, but it is suggested to prepare an aerator, an excavator or a trencher, corrugated drain pipe, and establish a method to apply the sand, whether using a top dresser or plan to in-dump the sand. Purchase enough sand to cover the entire project area, a minimum of 4 inches deep, and additional sand to tie in with the existing grade. Sand that meets USGA guidelines for putting green construction will work very well. However, If using another sand source, be sure to submit a sample to an accredited physical soil testing laboratory to confirm the sand is suitable to enable water movement and salt leaching, yet will retain adequate moisture and nutrients for healthy fairway turf. Remember that the key is to avoid sand containing excessive fine or very coarse material. A sand containing excess fines may not drain well enough to leach salts, while a very coarse sand will be too droughty to maintain quality turf. Step 2 is to define the project area and prepare the soil. Define an area well beyond the localized poor turf. Use this opportunity to fix as much area as possible. Aerate the project area with hollow tines, preferably 2 or more passes. Given that the project area is likely compacted, the holes created may only be 1 to 2 inches deep, and that's okay. The idea is to create voids and increase the potential for this site to accept water. Water the area deeply to encourage softer conditions. Once the area is nearly saturated, deploy a deep, solid tine aeration machine to fracture the subsoil. If the soil contains elevated sodium levels, consider applying a calcium amendment such as gypsum. Step 3 is to plan the drain locations and install the drain lines. Drainage is a critical element to the success of this project. 4 or 5 inches of sand on top of impermeable soil should not be expected to fix the problem. Drainage water must have an avenue to exit the fairway. Plan to cut the drain lines on 8 to 15 foot centers and use a herringbone design pattern. Cut the drain lines no less than 18 inches deep, and preferably 2 feet deep, into the subsoil. An excavator is suggested to cut the drain lines, but a trencher is acceptable. Line the bottom of the trenches with pea gravel and include a tracking wire. Use 4-inch diameter perforated drainage pipe and cover the drains with pea gravel to level with grade. Please note that the existing turf, regardless of variety, is not removed or chemically sprayed. The sand application, which is described in the next step, is simply applied on top of the existing turf. Step 4 is to apply the sand. And I will repeat myself here, use sand that meets USGA guidelines for putting green construction, or if using an alternative, submit a sample to an accredited physical soil testing laboratory. Remember that the key is to avoid sand containing excessive fine or very coarse material. The sand can be applied via a top dresser or simply by dumping the sand in the project area. The top dresser takes longer to apply the sand, but distributes the sand well over the project area. Float out the sand to tie in with the surrounding topography. Once the sand was dumped, Bill Todd and his staff used the excavator to distribute the sand, then followed by smoothing with a mechanical bunker rake outfitted with a belly cultivator and rake. Maintain moist sand to enable compaction and expedite the grow-in process. Dry sand will be too soft to provide a firm, level surface to sprig or sod, and will be more difficult to establish the new turf. Lastly, probe the entire project area to confirm the minimum sand depth is 4 inches following compaction. At Sun Lakes, the depth ranged from 4 inches to nearly 10 inches in the deepest areas. At Seville, the sand depth was consistent at 4 to 5 inches over the project area and gradually shallower to tie in with the existing topography. keep in mind that the new plane surface will be flatter than the former low-lying area. Step 5 is to establish the turf with sprigging, sodding, or seeding the project area. A good tip is to maintain moist conditions in the sand immediately prior to sprigging, sodding, or seeding. Moist sand will expedite the grow-in process. If sprigging, aggressively vertical mow a nearby fairway or rough area, so long as the area contains the same turf variety as in the project area. Harvest the material and distribute over the sand by hand. Wheel pack the sprigs with a mechanical bunker rake or cut in the sprigs with a slicer or similar machine. Mr. Rota at Seville successfully used this sprigging method. Conversely, at Sun Lakes Country Club, Mr. Todd sodded the project area with sand-based sod. Although the sod was a more expensive option, the area was able to be open for play in only 6 weeks. If using sod, be sure to purchase turf grown on a compatible root zone mix with the sand you have applied. If seeding the project area, the time needed before opening to play may be considerably longer, especially in northern locations with cool season turf such as ryegrass, bluegrass, or bentgrass. In step 6, the turf is ready for mowing. If the sprigging method is used, the area should be closed from early July through at least September in the desert southwest. When using sod, the area can be open for play, but not cart traffic, as early as 6 weeks after sodding. However, keep in mind that weather can be unpredictable and the closure time may need to be lengthened under unfavorable weather conditions. If seeding, which may be a better option in some areas of the U.S., but generally not in the Southwest, the time needed before opening the area to play will generally be considerably longer than either sprigging or sodding. The procedure detailed in this presentation has proven very successful for Seville Golf and Country Club and for Sun Lakes Country Club. These salt-laden areas now contain very low salinity, and root growth on both fairways has been impressive. The photo on the upper right of this slide shows the salinity in the 12th fairway at Sun Lakes just 7 weeks after the project began. If you remember earlier in the presentation, the EC meter registered 5.72 millisiemens in the same area, and now is only a fraction of that at 0.26. Improved turf health, as noted in the bottom photo, clearly speaks for itself. The following points summarize the process. Communicate the closure period to golf staff and membership and consider temporarily changing the hole to a par 3 if possible. Identify the project area and outline with paint. Aerate to decompact the subsoil. This is your best opportunity to fracture the subsoil and improve infiltration rates. Paint the drain lines and plan to install on 8 to 15 foot spacing and 2 feet deep into the existing soil. Apply enough sand to provide a minimum depth of 4 inches of compacted sand over the entire project area. Float out the sand to conform well with the surrounding grade. Wet and compact the sand to provide a firm, level surface. Vertical mow in nearby fairway or rough with the same turf variety or use sand-based sod. Allow enough closure time to establish healthy turf and a vigorous root system. Keep in mind that these areas will likely be droughty when compared to the surrounding soil and will likely need more frequent irrigation, at least initially. This procedure has proven very effective for both Mr. Rota and Mr. Todd, and I hope you will find similar success using this technique at your facility.
This has been a USGA Green Section How It's Done presentation. For more golf course management information, visit www.usga.org and select the Course Care tab.